Good morning, everybody. And it's very nice to see people, you know. I mean, I come from city of Bombay and I see many faces from city of Mumbai here. So, you know, some of them said that, you know, we meet probably in places which are out of Bombay. Very kind of you all to have come and joined us. You know, so hospital planning and infrastructure, as Faizan just introduced to you, is not a typical equipment kind of a expo or a conference that we are looking forward to develop. This needs to be more into hospital planning and infrastructure. You know, that is what the role play that we want this particular conference to take. We have had three fairly successful exhibition come conferences in Mumbai, and this year we thought that we will probably put up some road shows across three towns, you know, to see whether we could get more interest into this particular theme. But generally, you know, but Dr. Chandrashekhar here would agree with it. He's been trying very hard, you know, to popularize hospital engineering, hospital architecture, hospital design, hospital project management. A lot of people who have done that, and I think today we are going to share, you know, that with you. I think, you know, I won't give a keynote speech, but I would like to put up to you some of the key points which got delivered by the cabinet about 2 days ago on Wednesday evening when they approved the national health policy for India. And there are some many different things, you know, which are going to happen as a rollout for the next 10 years. I think this national health policy came up after 15 years. India didn't have a national health policy for 15 long years, you know. So some of those key points I thought I will share with you. You know, there's been a talk as to how do we reach out, you know, to people who need healthcare in hinterland India, you know. And we've talked a lot about teleconsultation, telemedicine, but there were little to show it on ground. So the policy, you know, says that we'd promote teleconsultation linkages, you know, which will link tertiary care institutions with smaller towns, you know. And as I came in the same flight, Dr. Deepak Parikh, who's an oncosurgeon himself out of Mumbai, is going to travel to, you know, Bhubaneswar tomorrow with a similar kind of a, you know, arrangement which is there. So I think this is something which we were lacking, so there is going to be focus on that. There will be also a national knowledge network for tele-education, tele-CMEs, tele-consultations, and a digital library. National Digital Health Authority, you know, which will be formed to regulate and develop digital health. You know, because mobile health and digital health probably is the only way that you can reach out healthcare to hinterland India. Introduction of electronic health record. So this is something which is very different than an electronic medical record. You know, we've heard a lot about EMRs in hospitals that you would come from. But EMR is specific to a hospital. Say for an example, if someone gets treated in Fortis fMRI in Gurgaon here and is to be transferred to Apollo Indraprastha, electronic medical record of Fortis is not available to doctors in, you know, Apollo. You'll have to create a new electronic medical record. So the government wants to, you know, come into picture by saying that there should be continuity of this electronic medical record, and this continuum should be from hospital to hospital. So be it public, private, private to private, public to private, like that. So I think that is something which is very good and which is going to happen. Then there is a comprehensive primary healthcare package, you know, which will be provided free of cost in all public hospitals, you know, which will have medicines also free, investigations also free in all public hospitals across. There will be a health card, you know, which will allow you to access this primary health care, free drugs and diagnostics, you know, which I've already mentioned, free health care to victims of gender violence in public and private sector, both. So you know, people who are from private sector should understand that there would probably be some burden, you know, coming your way as well. Creation of public health management cadre in all states. You know, many of us would have, you know, done hospital management courses, and I remember that Bombay Municipal Corporation at one point in time in Mumbai had it mandatory for its managerial cadre to have at least diploma in hospital management. You know, you cannot have otherwise people who don't understand management and how, and hospital is a very complex organization. You know, there is a lot of variability within the hospital operations. You know, if you go to an eye hospital, it will be different than a cancer hospital, will be different than a tertiary care, multi-specialty organ transplant is very different. Critical care management is another ballgame altogether. You know, so all of that, you know, so they're going to make it sort of create a public health management cadre. I think Delhi government also had once, if I'm not mistaken, advertised for about 200 management graduates, you know, to be hired by Delhi government. So there is a realization that you need better management of, you know, whatever public health systems we have. There is a new, you know, idea of to choose among healthcare facilities. So even if you go to a primary health center or a district health center in future, you'll probably find Ayush and yoga also available within the, you know, same building. You know, so there is going to be a thrust. Yoga is going to be probably made mandatory in schools. That is something, you know, which they have written there, that tracking behavior change, education, counseling at all levels. Now this is something, you know, which we should be again prepared for. This was not there earlier. Compliance to right of patients to access information on condition and treatment. Okay? And below that is also separate empowered medical tribunal for speedy resolution of disputes and complaints. So this is going to come now. You know, till now probably this was not so very, you know, focused area, but if this comes as a law, or if, you know, it comes in some other form, you will have to be geared up with sharing information which earlier you were not willing to share. Okay, so electronic health records and medical records will become, you know, will need to be prepared in a manner that this is going to be shared, you know, with the patient. So it will be his right to access his information. There is also going to be a new national healthcare standards organization, which will maintain adequate standards in public as well as private sector. So you have NABH, you have probably some other ISO 9000, JCI, all of those, but this is a new, you know, thing which will be National Health Standards Organization, NHSO. So this is going to be promulgated. There will be grading of, you know, establishments and active promotion of standard treatment guidelines. As we were coming in the airplane, Dr. Parikh was mentioning that there needs to be standardized protocols for treatment, especially when you're dealing with, you know, maybe cancer, for example. You know, across centers, treatment protocols will need to be same. We have faced the problem with tuberculosis. India's problem with tuberculosis happened because there were different standards of, you know, treatment which were followed by, you know, for tuberculosis. By the way, they have, you know, they have said that we will try to eradicate tuberculosis within this national health policy by 2025. Whereas the World Health Organization's goal is 2030, okay? And India probably has the highest number of tuberculosis patients in the country. So this is good, you know, that grading of establishments, you know. So as of now also, there is no grading of establishments. So once you probably get into grading, insurance, you know, will find it easier, you know, to charge the patient. So if you are, say, what happens, so this is a five-star hotel. It is graded as five-star hotel. There is also three-star next door and maybe others. But in hospitals, you're either NABH accredited or you're not NABH accredited. You know, so there is no grading of, you know, establishments, which probably will happen and probably might be better, so that, you know, people who don't have particular kind of standards are rated lower for certain services. So this is something which is new in the policy. Then the last, you know, point is about something to do with drugs, pharmaceuticals, and devices. So you have strengthening, you know, post-market surveillance program for drugs, products, and devices. Okay, so this is not going to be let loose. You know, we have recently, you know, got the jitters of how stent costs going down knocked off about 4,600 crores of the private healthcare industry. You know, so you had to suddenly wake up one fine morning and understand how are you going to make those numbers now work, because, you know, you had certain other numbers to play with. Regulating the use of devices to ensure safety and quality compliance, which India is not very strong in that, and we generally look for FDA approvals, you know, out of United States. So this is probably going to strengthen. And if we are going to make in India, you know, where there is a thrust in the national health policy, by the way, to make devices within the country, but that will have to be followed up by a regulation, you know, to ensure safety and quality. So this is something which is good. There will be timely revisions, you know, which will keep happening in the national list of essential medicines with appropriate price control. You've already seen that happening now. you know, and sir, I think oncology probably will slot into that because oncology drugs are also extremely expensive, you know, in terms of availability as well as, you know, otherwise. There is also going to be what you call as Aushadhi, Jan Aushadhi, you know, stores, which probably will deal with more generic, you know, drugs. And this, the successful story actually started from Indore and Jaipur, you know, Rajasthan state, where it was proven beyond doubt that these Jan Aushadhi centers probably make, you know, lower the cost of treatment by lowering the cost of, you know, drugs. So this is, you know, going to come in now, you know, for sure. There will also be standard regulatory framework, you know, for laboratories, imaging centers, you know, which we have seen proliferation of imaging centers, and some of them, as we see, probably should not have been approved, but probably they are not registered. So this is going to come in more stricter. So these are some of the highlights, you know, of the national health policy. I thought I will share that with you because it's very rare, you know, to get a document like that released by the government. It sounds pretty ambitious, you know, in terms of the goals that they have set up, you know, even raising the 67.5 years, you know, they want to raise the life expectancy to 70 years, you know, is what they are promoting. And probably they, you know, would. So what they are saying is that because of the policy being formed with the very active consultation with states, healthcare in India is a state subject. It's not, you know, so if it is done with the center and state together, probably the results, you know, will be better. Coming to today's, you know, program, so today's program is going to be focused more in terms of healthcare planning, design, you know, construction, also session on financial, you know, sustainability, and also how to build sustainable business models in healthcare, and also, you know, how to probably raise money for healthcare ventures. We've got, you know, fairly distinguished panels and speakers, and without wasting too much time, because, you know, it's a day-long process and we need to be on time. I'm already out by 5 minutes. The first panel discussion, let me, you know, is designing hospital and building the hospital in 21st century. Okay, so let me call upon, you know, the panelists. Martin Fiset, it's always a pleasure to meet this gentleman. So Martin is an architect by training, and he is founder of Fiset Hospiconsult, which operates out of Canada, but he's more Indian, if I can say so. Martin, you're more Indian now since the last one decade. So Martin has, to his credit, you know, he was the resident architect when Medanta was designed and built in Gurgaon, and after that he has held many others, you know, including the Aster Med City in Kochi, you know, where also he was part of that. He's also helping Dr. Trehan build the Medanta in Lucknow, and there are many others, you know, so I don't need to, and at the age as which he is, I think, Martin, you're almost 75 now, if I'm not mistaken, which is more active, you know, than many of us put together. All right, so he came once to our office in Mumbai, and then, sir, whole day, you know, he sat down with us and then went and did 1 hour swimming, okay? So please, ladies and gentlemen, welcome Martin Fiset. It's going to be difficult for me actually to manage this panel, because if you see the kind of people who are going to be managed, the next one, you know, is equally distinguished and has been my teacher, Dr. R. Chandrashekhar. He is doctor in the sense he is a PhD in medical architecture. He is probably the only one, you know, in the country who has done a PhD from England, you know, in medical architecture. Dr. Chandrashekhar used to head the architecture division in Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. He's been advisor on God knows how many, you know, policy bodies which are made. So if you are not happy with any policy, I think he's also part of that, you know. So you can probably take him on today when he comes on stage. So please join us on the stage, Dr. Ram Chandrashekhar. Then we have, you know, three people, you know, who are from the private sector. Rajesh, Sivan, who is head projects of American Oncology Institute. Rajesh earlier has worked with Fortis, you know, as head of their projects, and has recently joined, I think 6 months ago, joined this institute, American Oncology Institute. By the way, you know, there's a lot of interest around oncology in the country today. You know, Apollo wants to set up 21 centers, Kokilaben Ambani Hospital in Bombay wants to set up 19 centers. You know, there are many others, you know, but doctors from Mumbai wanting to set up center. We are doing something, 500 beds in Nagpur. So there's a lot of, you know, aura around cancer. So, you know, please join your hands, you know, to welcome Rajesh Sivan on the panel. The next one, actually, you know, Gaurav Diwan, who is an architect, who is a Delhi guy, I hope so, right? Gaurav, yeah. So Gaurav is an architect with 22 years of practice. He's director on the board of, you know, KGT architects, you know, who's based out of Bangalore, if I'm not mistaken. And Gaurav is also a member of the RICS. Apart from, you know, and what he shared with me was he actually wanted to become a doctor. Okay? So I had that problem with my son, you know, that I was forcing him to become a doctor, he became an architect. You know? So Gaurav, you know, but please join us on the stage. KGT has done a fair amount of healthcare architecture, and they are currently working with Fortis, if I'm not mistaken, you know, in Delhi for their expansion project. Last but not the least, and youngest of the lot, you know, I've had the good fortune of having worked with him in Mumbai, is architect Jayesh Dave. He is associate general manager architect Fortis Healthcare. Jayesh has also, like Gaurav, you know, had a penchant of doing medical architecture. He was working with Kokilaben Dhirubhai Ambani Hospital as a project architect when the whole hospital was built. If you see, I think one of the best signage systems that I have seen is in KDH, and he probably was the, you know, author of that. He's also done, if you have seen the Mumbai International Airport, the signage system also was designed by him when he used to work with Mutra. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jayesh Dave. Is there a hand mic available? All right, so without wasting too much time, let me just begin with first question to all of you all. And I think many of you probably would also want an answer to that, because I am asked as a, let me give you a brief introduction about myself. I am Dr. Vivek Desai. I am a medical doctor, gave a practice about 22 years ago, and ventured into hospital consultancy as a business. And today I run a company called HOSMAC, you know, which is present in Mumbai, Delhi, Bangalore, Middle East. We have about 150 people who work only for, you know, hospital projects, you know, which is both management consulting as well as designing, you know, hospital projects. But I am a doctor by profession, was rather by profession, no longer a doctor. The first question that comes to us whenever we also saw consult for any hospital is how much is going to be the area required. And this is especially for doctor clients who come to us. You know, if you tell them that you need, say, about 1,000 square feet per bed, you know, they're like, why for, what for? You know, why not 300 square feet per bed? You know, where, because it's mind-boggling. 1,000 square feet means they feel that why so much area is required. You know, and different hospital groups have worked with different thumb rules, you know, for area per bed. And I think Dr. Chandrashekhar can also tell us about how government, you know, looks at that kind of a problem. Because mind you, when you build a hospital, you know, you have to also service it. So I remember, you know, we designed the Asian Heart Institute in Mumbai. And after it was built and it was 6 months old, I could see Dr. Panda, you know, going into OPD rooms, switching off, you know, the lights and air conditioning system, or, you know, because at the end of the day, you have to service. Most hospitals now are centrally air conditioned. The more the area, the more the service that you require, you know, so that's the whole thing. So this has been a million-dollar question. I also don't have an answer to that, you know. So I would like to start with Martin, you know, from experience of international, but now working in India.
Okay. Can you hear me? Good morning. My first reaction to this question is to say, for what? I mean, what are the standards that you want to apply? Because this is the most important question I always ask my clients, is that are we talking about North American standards? Are we talking about European standards? Are we talking about local standards, Indian standards? Obviously, my experience has been, as Vivek mentioned, has been with Medenta, super specialty hospital, starting with Gurgaon. And in those cases, and of course after that there was Lucknow and Patna and maybe eventually Noida, starting with that, my experience has always been when they asked me how much, I said 110 to 120 square meters per bed. This has come true repeatedly. And of course, as I said, this is the standards that are applied there are people that you always refer to the FGI. You probably are familiar with the FGI guidelines. And those are the American guidelines, the guidelines that are applied in the US. And Medenta is in some cases beyond that and in some cases below that. For example, the FGI would say you have to have all private rooms, which is not the case in Medenta, and which is not the case in probably any hospitals in India, as far as I know. So the main factor that would determine...
So can I just interrupt? How much is per bed square footage in Medenta?
It's 120.
Square meters?
Square meters, yeah.
So it's about 1,200 square feet per bed. Am I right? Around that?
Well, it's more like, it's very close to 1,300, really. Okay. Yeah. So the tip-over factor is more like 11, 10 anyway. Where was I? No, what I was going to say is that one of the major impact that would have on the overall square meters per bed or square feet is what kind of patient accommodation you're going to have. Patient accommodation in a hospital represents 40 to 45% of the total, what I call the component gross area, so all of all the components of the services within the hospital. Now, if you go to all private hospitals, all private rooms, then you would increase that, obviously, and so your overall square meters per bed may go up to 125 to 130. You know, if you have more questions, we can get back to that later.
Okay.
Okay?
Dr. Chandrashekhar, from your perspective.
Good morning, everyone. Hope you can hear me. First, let me make it very clear why the concern of area. Area per bed is straight away affecting the cost. And any project cost, people like to have to start with basic thumb rule, at least they know where they are and how they are going to do. I'll give you a very clear picture of government as well as private because I handle both. Government in a large perspective for the reason where under this Prime Minister's Swasthya Suraksha Yojana we give, nowadays in the phase 3 we are going to give 200 crore each to all the government medical colleges to set up the super specialties for the reason they want to have more PGCs. As you know that the faculty is in a very short supply. Second is the private hospital, and generally people say government hospital you have area variation. No, I'll put it very clearly, which we are shifting it, the same paradigm shift also into this. When you do the area analysis, OPD, IPD and the technical area, frankly speaking, which I always put it like OPD where the patient is mobile and the doctors are stationary, IPD where the patient is stationary and the doctors and other instruments are moving around, and the technical area where the instrument or the gadgets are fixed and others are moving around. When you do area analysis, there what happens? Generally the waiting area goes in a big way in a government hospital, whereas there is very limited waiting area because it is by appointment. Private hospital, you have more private rooms comparative to general room. So that is the way area gets balanced. So a myth should be cleared that there is no variation as far as private or government hospital is concerned. Now efficiency. Efficiency, like Martin mentioned, there is a category. A, one is general hospital. B is general hospital teaching hospital. That is where MBBS is taught. Third is super specialty hospital, and fourth is super speciality with teaching. There are independent super speciality, then teaching. In my past 31 years I have spent on this, and particularly in past a decade, I had upgraded almost 30 medical colleges with super speciality. And I have interacted, I can proudly say, I haven't left even a single state in the country where I haven't visited, and most of the medical colleges I have seen. Lot of improvements, lot of problems, everything, and that's the reason the government is pitching in. One biggest challenge was, when you constrain the space, how you say 10,000 footfall in AIIMS, in OPD, is beyond imagination anywhere outside. Because I am a visiting professor in London South Bank University, so I handle the global parameter and our this thing. So what we have done, it took me 5 years to make them understand that when Tirupati Balaji can made a crowd management with technology, now online appointment and other thing, because majority of the people have mobile, etc. That is how we are trying to squeeze the waiting area so that even government this thing will be listened. So now the average, a normal 500 or the general hospital, you will get around 80 square meter per bed, means 800 square feet. If it is teaching, it is 120 to 110 to 120 square meter per bed. This is one part. If it is super speciality, generally what happens in the common super speciality which we have found, cardiology, cardiac surgery, neurology, neurosurgery, nephrology, urology, and gastric, surgical, and medical, and the burns and plastic. These are the one which we have seen in common that every institution is having. When we calculated, if it is teaching, then it comes to around 90 to 95 square meter per bed, depending upon the what kind of extraordinary gadgets they are putting in. And when it is non-teaching, it is between 85 and 90 square meter per bed. Now remember, square meter per bed, what we are talking about is with all the facilities along. We are not talking about the bed space. We are talking about the bed area required.
That would exclude parking. Excluding parking.
Excluding parking, obviously. And rest of the other services are all included in that.
So, Martin, you were saying parking is included in Medanta?
No. It's all excluded. But what I want to say also is that in that, at least the number I have, like Medanta, it includes the power plant, it includes all the other facilities.
I think that is included in Dr. Chandrashekhar's calculation also.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's what it means is there's no major difference between a hospital of the caliber of Medanta and, All India Institute of Medical Sciences.
I'll just like to share one more thing. When I was visiting one private institution in the same way, when I discussed with the doctor, he said, no, I need very spacious. So I have planned. I told him that you have wasted a lot of space. He said, no, I need it. Just after 1 year, when I revisited, he told me, you are right. I would have added 30 more beds. My return on investment would have been much better. Because space planning, and nowadays, I also advise, use the latest technology and latest equipment. Actually, initial capital cost may be more, but reduction in space gives you similarly the efficiency at the same time. So this is the categorized which out of my experience which I am sharing, that these are all built. Nothing we are talking on this. And when I was dealing with the 6 AIIMS like institution, there the each AIIMS which is 1,000 bedded with also trauma, nursing, paramedic institute, all put together and rehab, it was 1,40,000 square meter total. Because we started with 110.
1,000 beds?
1,000 beds. So this is what is the experience. Now what we are trying to do, government want to build AIIMS everywhere. So we said, you cannot do it like that. It's a manpower component, other thing. Therefore, they have started this upgradation of various medical colleges.
Existing medical.
In this AIIMS, we are going 750 and then onwards.
Okay. So, Gaurav, any different experience for you? I mean, does this sound, as an architect, I'm sure this would sound as music to your ears, right?
Yeah, it does.
All right. But does that happen in real world?
So I'm going to talk about my world just a little bit. And I bring the whole knowledge base of KG
1500 is in India. So I'll come to that a little later. Let me go to Jayesh, you know, because both of you next, you know, the both of them have worked with chains of hospitals, you know. I think, Rajesh, you were also with Vocard earlier and now with American. So Jayesh, you know, what is Fortis's take on this? You know, is Fortis also looking at 1,000, 1,200, 1,500 is what he was saying, or you are cutting it down? What would be fMRI?
It would be beyond 1,000.
Beyond 1,000. Okay. So it's much bigger. So this 1,000 would also stay for, say, tier 2 town or tier 3 town? You know?
Tier 3 can go to almost 850.
Okay.
But that again depends on the program.
Okay. Rajesh, what is your experience? You are now going into much smaller, tier towns.
No, we are going to a very smaller format. But earlier, the whole discussion of the square feet per bed starts from the boardroom.
Can you just very briefly tell them about what is American Oncology Institute?
Okay, American Oncology is a chain based out of Hyderabad, and it's under the CTSI, Cancer Treatment Services International, Pittsburgh. CTSI runs about 40, 50 centers out of US, and AOI in India is positioned as a primary cancer chain. Right now, we have about 3 hospitals running, and 2 are getting commissioned in the next 1-2 months. But the footprint is going to be around India and Southeast Asian countries, so like Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bangladesh. And we intend to set up around 15 to 20 of them in the coming 2 years. And it's purely cancer. The most important thing what I pick from what Dr. Desai told in the morning, that oncology treatment is going beyond treatment within centers. It's going to be a cloud-based, treatment planning. So soon you will see there's a standardization across the treatment planning that is being offered across any of the AOI centers, because the TPS or the physicist who does the planning sits out of one location, and the entire data or things have been managed through a cloud. So whether a hospital is going to be in Guwahati, the TPS would be done based out of Hyderabad center. And though it will be done there, originated, but it will be better through the Hyderabad center and put on the cloud. So there has to be a standardization across. So that's the USP where we come in from. And
with the area per bed, what's your experience?
So AOI per bed, as I said, starts from the boardroom. A decade ago, I remember it used the 600 to 700 used to be the threshold limit, nothing beyond that. And the best part is when they tell the board management thinks it's including parking. And when you say no, it doesn't include, they come back, what? It's not including parking, so how much is it? So it's evolved from there. And now I think we are pushed to 4-digit numbers like 1,000, 1,200. But I still feel that from the business point of view, the square feet per bed for a given chain or a given organization would depend on the location of the hospital. So I don't think it's fair to compare something in Bombay versus probably something in a city like, say, Amravati tomorrow, where the cost of the property is going to be quite different. So where the real estate cost is high, you tend to keep it at low for the same organization. We have seen Fortis's and Vocards doing in a range of 600, 700, all the way up to 1,000. I have seen very good centers of Vocard which are sub 500 square foot, but they are at a different location. And a space, where, I mean, at a location where real estate is very premium. So it's very unfair to peg one number as this is what it should be. It should be purely driven by what the business is. What sort of mass you are capturing, as Dr. Chandrashekhar rightly said, you need to see which part of the hinterland of India you're going, and does the business really need that sort of thing? Are you going to get money out of it?
So let me put this question to all five of you. And just I just want, you know, one in terms of number. Okay, so if you want to put up a hospital that you would run, Rajesh, what would be square foot per bed?
750.
Jayesh?
1,000.
Go on.
900.
Sir?
850.
Martin?
Well, you know, I have, you know, one thing I want to say also, which I didn't say it just briefly, I also have a client in Bangladesh, okay, a big 500-bed hospital. It's going to be, that's what the client wants, it's going to be almost all single bed. Okay, so that's 130. Square meters per bed. I would say Medanta, 120, 110, 120. This is Lucknow, this is Patna, this is Gurgaon.
So let me ask, you know, anyone from the, you know, Prashant, you've been in tier two towns, you've been, you know, sir, anyone from you, do you think that what is a good figure? Have you ever done this before?
Can you tell us the figure for AIIMS Delhi? Do you have that?
AIIMS Delhi?
Do you have a figure for it?
No. Because AIIMS Delhi has grown. Like, you know, it started with something and it is all packed. But the second campus, one in Jhajjar and another one which is adjoining that Masjid Mood, they are all around 85. It means 850.
Yeah, I tried at AIIMS and I mean, I find it hard to believe that AIIMS has a 1,000 square
feet per
No,
but the one thing that you should remember, sir, is that it is not only the area, so it includes everything. It includes the lobby, staircase, everything. Prashant, would you like to add something? Any question also on this? You could, yes, sir.
Around 800 to 900 square feet, if you are looking from the viability perspective. Because now with the private equity driving the return on the investments very heavily, so we need to look at the viability also. Again, it's not a very straight question where which I answer, but then we need to be sensitized, you know, whether it is in tier one or a tier two, tier three location.
Yeah, Dr. Parekh, you want? I'll just go to him and be back with you.
The same point that you mentioned, that do you ever...
Can you just, you know, briefly, I'm sorry I didn't, you know, tell you to do that, but introduce yourself so that, you know...
Sorry. I'm Dr. Deepak Parekh, director at the Asian Cancer Institute, Mumbai. There's a group of ex-Tata hospital people. We're all consultants, and we have put up our own money and built this hospital at the Sion, along with the Somaya Hospital, support of that.
It is good, sir, you came here, because, you know, I probably will have a leeway, because they're forcing me to do it in 700 square feet. None of them has said that.
No, I think the question which he rightly raised is, do you ever look at the return of investment and then decide the area rather than just sticking to an area itself? As was mentioned, that which city you are in, what is the demand of that particular...
So I think the next question, sir, is going to address that. Right. Okay.
Can I make just one small comment? In Medanta, there are only single and double rooms. There is no ward in Medanta. Okay? That's a very important consideration.
Yeah, but what doctor said was, you know, that hospitals like, you know, government or charitable trust owned hospitals have more number of patients in the outpatient clinics, yeah, as compared to, you know, the others. Probably there will be some setting off there.
Okay.
Very quickly.
Yeah, hi, good morning. I am Shubham Doshi from Doshi Consultants. We are project consultant in pharmaceutical and we are into hospitals also. Recently we have designed a Hari Om hospital, which is a cancer care hospital in Indore, taken by Shelby Group. It is at 700 square feet.
Okay. So you wanted to say something, and I move on. This is the last.
Good morning. My name is Shamit Manchanda. I'm from Manchanda Associate Architects. We primarily do healthcare projects. It's a question to the panel. Ms. Rajesh said that you had a work hard hospital at 500 square feet per bed, plus if people are aware of Delhi government is also pushing for 500, 600 square feet per bed. The question is, what are the disadvantages that are there when we reduce these areas to 500 square feet per bed as compared to 1300, 1400 square feet, or even an average of 1,000 square feet per bed?
What will be the quality control requirements?
So I would anyone like to respond now before Rajesh?
So I'll take this. Definitely there is, you have to give away something when you go down that path of reducing square feet per bed to match the business need. But primary thing, what we keep in mind, or what one should keep in mind, is not to touch the patient safety and the patient comfort part of it. What you may go down is in certain back-end areas, like we do have a lot, if you look at your whole space planning model, Martin may correct if I'm wrong, 50% of your spaces go into clinical space. And the rest 50 is your inpatient, where the where your patient actually is stationary and is the caregiver area, the basic area. So the 50% of the clinical space, out of that 50%, which is 25%, is somewhere you can play out your numbers on the space plan to bring down the area per bed. You may not, so for example, if you're at 230 per bed on a single room, which is today considered as very good, given the grid size or whatever it is, you may scale it down marginally, say going to 210, not further beyond, because that will actually impact your whole square feet per bed on the patient side. So which you don't sell, which you rarely do. So we have seen OTs from 250, 300 square feet onwards, the minor OTs to about 600, 700, 750, 800 square feet OTs.
Just to interrupt you that, would there be some standards, you know, applicable there, isn't it? I think there is an NABH standard that corridor width cannot be less than 8 feet.
Those are governed by the fire norms and all. Yeah. So like the regulatory norms are very tight. So you can't touch certain areas like your corridors and all, as you rightly said. You can't touch regulatory areas like your oncology areas or radiation areas where AERB has to approve. So those you can definitely tamper with.
I think, you know, Shamit, what you were asking, my, you know, thing, and they can probably add or say if I'm on the right track, is generally what gets sacrificed, that's what you were trying to seek, right, are things like, you know, dirty utility, you know, which probably wouldn't have heard about what is dirty utility, you know, or an equipment wheelchair bay for parking. It's generally in the corridor. You know, clean utility, you don't have that concept. Nurses, you just give them a desk. Yeah, that's the way that you are actually, you know, cutting the corner. Because like he said, you can't cut an OT. It won't fit otherwise. You know, you can't cut an intensive care unit. Also, probably you squeeze in. There are norms around what should be the distance between the beds. So if you want a hospital which is a JCI accredited or an NABH accredited, I think then you probably wouldn't be able to cut that beyond a limit. So that limit, probably what is coming so to is about 800 to 900, and I think it fits in.
Precisely.
Major area is waiting area and the lobbies and lounges and those kind of a thing. You can have, and nowadays, these are also cut down because of the technology. Like, you know, you interact in a technical way rather than, you know, all the time every day in this thing. Yes.
All right. So let us put that to vote. If I say that 800 square feet is a good ballpark.
No, you cannot do that. In my opinion, I'm sorry. You cannot do that because it all depends on the standards you want to apply. There is no magic. You know, there's no magic. You know, 500 square foot per bed or square meters per square foot per bed, there is no magic there. And don't think that your architect is cheating somewhere. Okay, he's not cheating. He's following a program. He's following what you have instructed him to do. Because let's not forget that there are some rooms, as the man over there mentioned, there are some rooms. An MRI room is going to be always the same size, whether it's 500 square feet per bed or it's 1,000, 1,200. It's all going to be the same
size. All right,
so
we'll now come out of this square footage business because, you know, this will become a little...
What are the standards you want to apply?
Yes, ma'am.
What are your patient accommodation?
She's a lady, I can't say her no. Yeah.
You see, See, I'm Dr. Khanna from Dharamshila Cancer Foundation and Research Center. We run an exclusive cancer hospital, 300-bedded. When we started it, I had no concept of areas and everything else. While listening to all of you, the area that I have, the plot area, and what we have built, it is working to about 500 square feet, and we have huge waiting area. We have OTs 22 by 22. We have three linear accelerators. We have brachytherapy. We have MRI, PET CT. You name it, we have everything, you see. Bone marrow transplant unit. And we are fitting into 500. We are quite comfortable. We don't feel the scarcity of
all the best.
At all. Any one of you can come and visit the hospital and decide for yourself, where are we short?
Their only thing is, when the bed numbers goes high,
right,
the area gets reduced.
You see,
because the support services for all the beds.
Right.
You see, if I build a 100-bedded hospital,
right,
and I build 750 or 800-bedded hospital, I have built in Bangladesh 64 square meter per bed, and it is a 450 bed, and all super speciality.
You won't believe, because
they don't have space, but it has to be done. But what I'm trying to say, waiting area or this thing is not, besides that, more the beds, the area comes down.
But you have really put me into spot of trouble, ma'am.
You see?
I was fighting for 700. You have told them 500 now.
See, the only difference is, out of these 300 beds, 100 beds are general beds. 100 beds general ward, because oncology being expensive. So let's
go to the next question, because that's equally important. So next question to the panel is that, you know, the next one apart from area is how much is going to cost the building part of it. Forget the equipment. Okay, how much it is going to cost? So can I just take a ballpark from the audience first? What do you think? A hospital building, you know, which is complete construction, interior, air conditioning, you know, lifts, elevators, facade, everything put together, what do you think would cost you?
Without medical equipment.
Can I give you a wild guess?
It will change from 3,500 rupees a square foot to 7,500 rupees a square foot.
7,500 rupees a square foot.
Upper limit, 5-star.
I see. Yes, sir.
That's a lot.
This is music.
including clean room panels and everything. Because nowadays...
Anyone else has any different opinion?
Everyone is going for modular clean room panels.
Pardon? You are an architect? Okay. Oh, you've done this work?
Yeah.
Okay.
We also specialize in healthcare architecture.
Okay. Sir, now coming to you. Let me start with, you know, sir, you. Because, okay, you know, with the public hospitals, which are generally not centrally air-conditioned, you know, to someone like an fMRI or a Martin, you know, or Rajesh, or even you are all corporate guys. So, you know, what is your ballpark? Let's, you know, hear from you.
In fact, the point you raised, in public hospital, particularly in government, the bed component is more important. When we tell them, we cannot give you more than 200 crore, they say, sir, give me 300 bed, don't give me air conditioning, all the wards I can run cross ventilated, but I need bed. That is more important. That is how the focus goes. Presently, I can share the cost, which is all tendered cost, which is recently done. Lately we have got around 4,500 rupees a square feet, lately. This is super speciality, huh? I'm not talking about general, with all latest and even theaters, etc. And when you try to see with the equipment, all super speciality. Lately, we built Safdarjung Hospital with super speciality and the biggest emergency so far in the world. 500-bedded emergency you might not have even heard of. This is because of every time AIIMS, go to Safdarjung. Anybody, go to Safdarjung. So, this is a big issue. But of course, we are fighting it for the equally the manpower, etc. But these, I have come out almost 90 lakhs to 1 crore per bed, including equipment.
Including equipment.
Yes, yes.
No, I was just asking about the building.
No, and the building is here also, here we came around 3,500
rupees square foot. So, Gaurav, what is your experience of?
Ballpark sits between
4,500 to 5,500.
I think it's 5,000 is the right number, what we have been working on.
5,000.
It works. It works with sub 5,000. And I agree with Dr. Chandrashekhar that that's the range we should look at.
Okay.
But one very important fact there is, again, you know, this the number also is directly driven by the type of finish that you need. So you may not want to go to that particular level. So
you can want to come back to you on this number also. So you please, you know, find out how much it
we don't want to again get a shock, but you know.
Yeah, no, because I am also a little bit shocked. So Martin, your number? Any idea?
I never get involved into the cost. Sorry.
Okay. All right. Okay,
other people look after that.
Thing to add here.
Yeah.
And that is an observation. And that is that in order to, in the corporate hospital scenario, there are a lot of materials that we'd like to use or have been trying to use over the last 10 years, which are, let's say, international level. A lot of those materials were not available in India. So they had to be imported specifically for one project or two projects. What is changing today is that a lot of those manufacturers from across the world are now setting up shop or have set up shop because they have enough business in India. So my sense is that going forward, although there is escalation and inflation that we're dealing with, a lot of the materials that are international level materials, because their prices are going to fall because of volumes, we may move slightly lower down from 5,000, and it's pure economics.
You know, for me, if I, because I, as a consultant, we first have to make a financial viability model, yeah. Okay? If I put in 5,000 rupees a square foot, I'll be shot dead.
Yes.
You know, he's nodding his head. You know, I'm telling you that because promoter is not willing to take that at all. Except, you know, maybe Fortis probably will take or Asian would take, Medanta will probably take, but bulk of it, you know, because these are not, so say I'm doing a tier two town. I'm doing projects in Tirupati, Guwahati, you know, Raipur, Nagpur, Nasik, Baroda. You tell them this 5,000 rupees a square foot and all, they said we will change the consultant. You know, no, I'm not joking. I'm very serious about it, you know.
Now,
let me ask you, ma'am, that how much did you, you know, your building cost you?
Since we have made it in phases, you see, so I can't tell you the figure. We made the first phase was 100 beds only with all the, you see, diagnostics and two linear accelerators. And then the second phase came with 200 additional beds and ICUs and all that. So I wouldn't be able to tell you the comprehensive cost.
So
needs to joining a political party.
Dr. Desai.
So, you know, Prashant would... In Agra, 2,500. No, so one point which, you know, Gaurav said, and I think everyone will agree, that there are certain materials which are coming in, and I think I will touch upon, as Dr. Chandrashekhar said, that there's something now called pre-engineered building concept, you know, where you have, I have been associated with two of them. Mm. One didn't have a very good ending, though, you know, the edifice stands, it's in Ramano Lohia Hospital. It's a steel structure. With everything there was modular, actually. Even, you know, the flooring or... We used Tata BlueScope, you know.
No, if you want to see and go and see, 1,600-bedded pre-engineered structure, completely finished, 2,700 rupees per square, Ahmedabad, that Patel Institute. That was amazing and shocking for me also. And this is what is the reality.
Okay, so, you know, so he's saying that maybe the scale was big.
Yeah,
so
scale was probably, big, you know, very big.
There. There is also another Calicut, you know, is a town in Kerala,
yeah,
where
correct.
There is a company called KEF. I think I would encourage you to go to the Google and do this KEF, you know, K-E-F. That's the name of the company. That's India's first pre-engineered building, you know, construction company, which does turnkey projects, you know. So they were set up only 3 years ago. And to prove a point, that gentleman actually set up a 400 or 300
250 bed, the one which is ready now,
in Mytra. You know, where it was actually built off-site and transported to Calicut. It was about 700 kilometers away from where the factory is in Krishnagiri near Salem, you know, in Tamil Nadu. So, so those kind of materials will cost. So their report, when came to us for due diligence, you know, and the bankers were, I think, State Bank, if I'm not mistaken. They said, we don't agree that, you know, how can you have 6,000 rupees a square foot for a hospital where the average banking industry, when they vet projects, they are willing not to go beyond 4,000, 4,500 at best. So it was a real tough time for us to explain to them why it is costing this, you know, because there's value for what has been done. It's, you know, and it's concrete, it's not steel.
It's concrete.
No, it's complete concrete pre-engineered, you know, kind of a building. The toilets were just brought and just transplanted. So there is some element of that material if you want to be superior material. Let me just come back to, say, maybe Jayesh and tell us, Jayesh, that would a quota stone, you know, or a granite, which is cheaper as compared to some other materials that we use today, good enough for, you know, hospitals? Where is this money otherwise goes, like he said, you know, in finishing mostly, right? Flooring everyone likes nice, you know, the elevation everyone likes nice. So what is your, you know, as a, at a group level, do you think of these kind of things, what Gaurav just said, cost of material?
Yes, we do.
Okay.
So it again depends on which areas are public areas and which are functional areas and which are services areas where visitors are not visited. So probably an AHU room would have a quota flooring, or some other rooms where there is no visitors, they would have a quota flooring. But obviously in public spaces like a lobby, we might even have an Italian floor. Or in general corridors, we would certainly go for granite. So that is an option for us.
Okay.
I just would like to make another comment that's not really related. If you want to reduce the total cost of a building, what I would suggest you do is do a very detailed, complete, functional program to start with. Dr. Desai mentioned that at the very beginning. That's what determines cost, because that will determine space, okay? And to prepare a detailed, functional program should be an excellent opportunity to revise your procedures and your policies and go to a lean, L-E-A-N, hospital. Mm. Are we spending too much space on this or that? Can we group activities? Can we be more efficient in using the space and so on? So I think this is very important. To come back to the pre-engineering building, I guess we'll treat that later. What you mentioned here as a pre-engineered building, for me, from what I understand, is really a steel structure, correct?
Yes.
It's not a modular building that you build the modules in the factory and you bring them on the site. That, in my opinion, I don't know if you come back, is also another solution.
Yes.
And if you want, I will mention that later, but I mentioned it now. I actually was fascinated recently by the fact that they use shipping containers to do all kinds of things in the world. You know, they do houses, they do hotels, they do students' residence. And I thought, why not a hospital? Why not a community health center? So I designed one with 30 beds made out of shipping containers. If you're interested, I will show it to you.
And this is available
but
here,
sir,
in Krishnagiri.
But, you know, pre-engineered building necessarily need not be steel alone.
No. This is what he talked about. What he's mentioning about that is in Krishnagiri, there is already a plant. And the Kochi, they have already built a 150-bedded hospital. It's all, everything is
done in the factory.
Computer. Yes, that Krishnagiri is a huge plant they have put in.
Okay.
And there,
this
we have
is the KEF what he's talking about.
And this is that the costing which we have called them, that how much it at site cost, the few analysis we found, it is around 5,000 rupees.
Yeah. So that is a high end.
That's a high end. And very quick.
Yeah.
To extend what Martin said, pre-engineering is, from our perspective, it used to be steel.
Yes.
And like.
But it is not necessarily steel. That's
no,
what
it's
I'm
a combination.
To
so
this case, the guy who built this Matra Hospital in Calicut is no steel.
It's
it
all
is complete concrete.
100% concrete.
Why do you call it pre-engineered?
Because it was you know, brought. Like how you bring steel, you know, like you put a steel,
a
column.
It was prefabricated.
It was prefabricated.
Components.
It's called a prefabricated building.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's a difference. It's a difference.
I'm not saying that. Why? Because what happened was they also, when you do say engineering, MEP, so they actually bring the MEP in tray.
Yep.
Which is already laid out. So there is a duct. There is a chilled water pipe. There is a plumbing pipe. There is a fire pipe. There is electrical conduit. Everything is stacked in the tray. Okay, the tray is numbered, so if this is say ground floor or basement of Lee Meridian, you know, banquet hall number 1, so it will carry that. They just come and stick it up, that's all. They just, you know, pieces of maybe 10 meters to 5 meters. Yeah, it was fantastic to see, honestly. So that is why I said it's pre-engineered. You know, not only the concrete, they do it for everything.
What was the time of construction?
20 months for a 4 lakh odd square feet building.
Okay.
Even less. Finished. Now they are coming to an extent that they want to do it everything in between 12 and 15 months.
So the first one took a lot of time because they had spent almost a year for engineering, part of it in Krishnagiri. And I think they did it in about 20 months.
20 months? The plant only 3 year old.
Now,
but the only thing is the G plus 2 structure. And there's a lot of land around. So it's a more a ground floor. G plus 4.
This is another point I want to make. If you want to save money, make your hospital horizontal. I know the land is very expensive, but a horizontal hospital is cheaper than a vertical hospital. I really believe that. Okay. The second thing is that don't forget that if you cheat on the quality of your finishes, it's going to catch up with you eventually.
Yes.
If you cheat on the quality of your mechanical system, it's going to catch up with you eventually. If you're cheap on your facade, it's going to catch up with you eventually. So we have to think about life cycle cost, not just first cost.
Yeah.
Sorry.
You see, one of our blocks which we built in 2006, in the top floor, the fourth floor, has the bone marrow transplant unit. We had put in the steel to have it as a seventh floor building. Now we want to add extra space. And we're in a dilemma because bone marrow transplant unit, you see the infection control and all that, and when the construction is going on, a lot of fungi and all that is going to be there. So this prefabricated structure, or the already constructed 6,000 square feet kind of a plate, can we do it?
Yes, you can with the puff panels, and there are infection control parameters are taken care. There are plenty of material available.
There are engineering, you know, solutions to most of the problems that we have. Let me just shift gear now. Is there any question you want to ask about the cost? Okay, all right.
I am architect Suhas Dighe from Pune, and many Ahmedabad architects come down to give their projects presentation in Pune. I asked everyone how much you have spent on insulation because they are using steel and concrete the most in our country. They were speechless. They said, no, we are. So I asked them, if you are prominent, then you give us a solution. No, we will follow them. So what is your opinion?
No, in fact, now the insulation, in fact, he is the one who has introduced that also. Insulated panels are available and everybody is using it because of the global warming and the kind of energy guzzling which he is going to talk about in the next
point.
Sir,
he is actually, I think, asking about how to, you know, coat the steel with that Jotun paint, no, fire rating. That's
yes.
What you are asking.
Yeah,
you
no.
He asked each and every architect, including Mr. Doshi, how do you do that?
And then there is a fire rated paint for that. So all international airports, even say Delhi, has that paint. That paint is very expensive.
See, I'll tell you, I'll answer you. External walls are insulated with as per the rating and the climatic. Internal, we all go for drywall nowadays, and drywall has a variety of things as per your need. You can do it. Those are also insulated where you need, where you don't need. Insulation, by putting insulation or with the cavity, all are possible.
Cavity wall is the real solution.
No. Cavity wall was one of the solution. I can say like that. Because the technology has advanced enormously now. Cavity wall was the one which was happening. Mm-hmm. Even now, I'll tell you with the government perspective, some of the areas, I still in the government area, I tell them in ICU, etc., don't use drywall because there they think anything and anything they want to put the gadgets, etc., they don't choose the right this thing. So, not to take a chance because everyone, you cannot keep on educating that for this cement background, cementitious, this is the
so
type of.
You can't hang a monitor, you can't do that.
Because they have the flexibility. Anytime they want to change the thing.
Let me just come to the next point because due to time limitation, I have to wind up by 11:30. The next important thing, which you know, very close to my heart also, and I think all of you will agree, we once did a survey for CII across the country of about 40 hospitals. This was about 4 years ago. Figures would have changed, but would have remained the same is my gut feel. We were spending about 600 rupees per bed per day as electricity cost alone. Okay? Because now all hospitals are centrally air conditioned. So we run 24 hours, 365 days. We are guzzlers of electricity. So I think, you know, and all of you would have.
HVAC is the main
killer.
Culprit, main culprit.
Okay.
50%
So can you guys, you know, tell us some tip points as to how you could be a sustainable hospital? Because problem is going to remain. I don't want to spend the money, you know, because I am going to.
So sustainability.
Both capex as well as opex wise. Yeah. So maybe
can I interrupt just 1 second? Sorry, can I just interrupt 1 second? Are these prefabricated buildings NABH safe and earthquakes?
Without that, you can't question. Get permission
so
to
just
build.
To give an example, about a year ago, we just finished while we were in, I was in Fortis. We finished expansion building of Fortis, about 120,000 square feet steel. Approved by the local authorities and fire and everybody, so it's proven. So earlier it was not, but that's they have included it. So coming to your question of this sustainability, I think sustainability comes at a cost. There is some added cost when you want to actually get into that sort of model. So HVAC being a very prime guzzler for energy, probably that's one space we all look at how you can reduce that. So a lot of more and more hybrid models are coming in now. So days are gone when we used to use only a chilled water system or the air cooled system. So we got into a hybrid like a VRV or a chilled water mix where your initial capex cost is high, but your running cost will be lower. VRV driven AHUs have started coming in the last 5 years now. So even some of the critical care where you need two stage filtrations especially are being driven by VRV.
So would you go for a chiller or you would go for a VRV?
So you go for a mix. Typically, we have done 100% VRV also, where even the...
What size of an hospital?
230 beds.
Entirely VRV?
Yeah, full, 100% VRV.
Okay.
And it's functioning. The thing is, energy, the initial capital cost is slightly higher because you have to use all those connecting kits and all those stuff. Because
I thought for a capacity of 230 beds, you know, chiller probably would have been a better solution.
Yeah, it also depends on, see, nowadays the green people are acquiring spaces and fitting it out and retrofitting, so you may not have space to keep a chiller or something.
Okay. These are old existing buildings.
So existing buildings you take over. So it's a large hospital in Chennai,
okay.
So which is 100% VRV.
Okay.
And that model has actually worked even for smaller formats, even for 100 bed formats. So HVAC is one key thing probably where you can look at. But if you go to the sustainability route of choosing certain materials, which are engineering materials which are sustainable, then you have to keep a 5 to 8% markup on your cost.
Capex?
Capex.
Okay.
On your, yeah, capex.
Oh, the building capex or HVAC?
Building capex.
Building capex. That's
huge. Yeah, that's
huge. Okay. Jayesh, anything? Is Fortis Hospital, you know, rated as LEED or Griha or anything? Griha it is. Is it a policy? Is it a policy or, you know?
VRV. Variable
refrigerant. I'll just come back to you, sir.
Yes, we follow sustainability, but it depends again the kind of projects we are doing. Most of the projects which we are having, they are like bolt-ons or expansions of the current hospital. So obviously the HVAC systems are different as compared to what we are trying to propose for a new expansion. Even in terms of lighting, obviously now LED needs are in, but also we are trying to add more solar panels, available space we are able to achieve in the terraces. So yes, as a policy, we are proceeding towards it, but there are a number of challenges in terms of the initial cost involved in it.
Okay. Gaurav, anything that...
I think the biggest challenge for us that comes up for the MEP consultants who work with us is to figure out how to recover heat in the HVAC system. And in the past, we've not had hospitals being really efficient in terms of buildings because the focus has been to shift somehow from the old hospital, which was there, let's say, with the white tiles and the smell of, you know, of the disinfectant when you walked in, to a newer hospital, which is more hospitality, you know, based. And that has till now taken up and been part of the transition more than energy efficiency. But I think it is definitely the way forward. And we are constantly looking for you know, solutions and options where we can. But lighting, solar panels, heat recovery, besides what Rajesh said.
Can you tell us some design solution from as an architect?
See, design solutions for us, our biggest challenge that we're getting is that the plots of land are reducing in size.
Uh-huh.
And orientations, which is one of the biggest things in terms of passive, you know, functioning in terms of energy efficiency, is not in my control anymore.
Mm-hmm.
If I had the option that Martin is saying that I could have a large tract of land, I would orient it in a manner mm-hmm. where I catch the sun correctly. I am sensitive to that. But to build a 2 lakh square feet on a 1 acre plot doesn't, which is facing, you know, specific site where frontage is more important than...
So design is not the solution, but technology is. That is
what
you're...
Yeah, it has to be technology-based with the pressures of economics of growing India today.
Okay.
It is. And that's really where it sits.
Can we, sir, play with, you know, maybe the exposure of windows to bring in more...
See,
that we do, for sure.
See, one thing is first, you said limitation, but orientation and this passive architecture is the first step. There is no denial. Number two, for audience, I am also a chairperson for IGBC Green Healthcare Rating, which has been released just few months ago in Mumbai.
This is for healthcare buildings, actually.
Only for healthcare, which is nowhere existent. Other areas also, they do the simulation, etc. with this thing. Here, the focus, major focus on infection control and the, you see, nature is a great healer. Everyone understands. And even focus on evidence-based design, which is now really a important thing for most of this corporate hospital. I don't know even what is happening, what is the weather outside. That is why we are trying to build in. Even Amitabh Bachchan, when he was explaining in Karodpati, he said he was in the Breach Candy Hospital. He said, yeah, such a wonderful sea is there. Why don't you tilt my bed at least? And he wrote poetry on that. So nature is a great healer. That is how this green healthcare rating, please go through. It is in IGBC website. It is free. You can download. And even anybody needs it, we can send it across. That's not a problem. It is digital, this thing available. And because of this, some of the states and corporation has given you extra FAR.
That was, I was coming to that. Is there any incentive that
It is. In fact, Pune was the first one.
Okay.
And now the Maharashtra, when it was released, the urban development secretary was there. And everywhere the incentive, like you are giving an extra for parking or service floor, etc. If you are following minimum gold rating IGBC, you are getting something. And platinum, this one. I was told
any
in some
electricity
of the,
tariff subsidy?
No, they are trying to give you some, you know,
property tax, some things.
There are different people are giving different kind of a,
okay,
this thing, because everyone is sensitive about promoting green,
okay,
and sustainable. We know now they are realized. And this central air conditioned, wherever, because of this, now a lot of places, even outside, I'm talking about the Germany, etc., where people are always into the enclosed. When I used to ask about any norms, he said, what norms? We follow standards. Because ours is a controlled environment, put it anywhere, we manage this, these are the standards. Now they are also seeing with the warmth, the temperature rising, the opening and, you know, the natural ventilation, because all the month, all the time we don't need. Another big thing which is important.
So what is your opinion, since you mentioned that, do the hospital building need to be centrally air conditioned?
Not all the area.
Okay.
Depending upon the you know, where your thing is located, what climate, etc.
There's some norm, no, sir. NABS says some 2 air changes per hour has to be mandatory in all public spaces also.
No, now you tell me when I have a cross ventilated, what is the air change? It is fantastic air change. No, nothing. When SARS hit the country, those cross ventilated, this thing has never had a problem.
Okay.
What we face the problem, that is the reason. Now what is we are doing in all air conditioning? The filtration trapping the pathogen, they are not killed. And swine flu and these have given the alarm. And like I handle the TB program, and UV has become a very important factor, and you know it is very expensive how we have to manufacture and get it done. So today also I think a day or this thing, UV has playing a major role in air conditioning system.
Ultraviolet.
Pass
the air through an
ultraviolet. Germicidal irradiation and also photohydroionization. These are the one which is important, which has to be built with the system. Depending, I'm not saying everywhere, but you have to, you know, check the system.
Okay.
And obviously, the air conditioning, there is a huge range of, you know, energy saving.
Available. So, Martin, you know, you've done monster of hospital. So do you think, you know, sustainability, did you follow that, you know, in any of these, or is the promoter keen to do that?
No, they are. But what I wanted to say is that I come from one part of the world where it's cold, and you know that, where it can be very often minus 30 to minus 40 below zero. So we take extreme care in the way we design our outside wall, because this is where the major saving will take place for your mechanical system. We built entirely airtight building with vapor barriers and air barriers. The whole building is absolutely airtight. I don't think that has come to India yet, this kind of attention to the composition and the rating of the outside wall to make sure that there's absolutely no leak. Because if you have a leak, then you're air conditioning the outside, and that is costly.
Yeah, just, you know, before I go to them again, can you just raise hands, you know, people who think hospital building should be centrally air conditioned? One, two, three, four. Thoda piche dekho sir, aur haath uthenge. Okay, so fair number. And those who don't believe, can someone tell that, you know, why you don't think hospital should be centrally air conditioned?
It depends on the standards.
I'll come to that. Sir, can you use the mic? You are an architect or a hospital owner?
I'm an architect.
Okay.
So we say, I'm saying that it depends on...
Sir, name?
I'm architect Brij Panjwani from Dehradun.
Okay. Beautiful country.
Oh, yeah.
That Dehradun, yeah. Beautiful place.
So I'm saying that it depends on where the building is located. It depends on the microclimate that is there. And accordingly, it can be designed. Some spaces would be required to do that, but not all the spaces. Okay. But if you have a very hot climate, you have a humid climate, you may go for the total air conditioning.
So not in Dehradun, but in Delhi, yes?
Dehradun also partially, yes, because the climate is changing there now.
Okay.
With the traffic increase.
Even Mysore is getting warmer now.
Okay. All right. So someone who said, yes, it should be. So Gaurav, can I pick on you?
Flexibility and individual access or control, you know, I'm a patient or I'm a user, let's put it that way. It could be staff, it could be patient, family member, but just having that ability or flexibility to turn the air conditioner on or off without compromising, you know, the healthcare aspects. I should have that flexibility.
So let me tell you, you know, apart from what he just said, we had a very peculiar problem, you know. So we did a Believer Church Medical College teaching hospital, sir, in Kerala. Kerala is not a very hot thing. But general wards were kept out of AC. Okay, now the problem that happened, and that typically happens, there's Holy Family Hospital in Bombay, which also has that kind of problem, that you have a air conditioned floor above, air conditioned floor below, and in middle you have general ward, it sweats. So whether you like it or you don't like it, you know,
no,
we had to actually replace, you know, certain things, because the false ceiling started to stain and all kinds of problems started to happen, fungal growth, you know, for all that matter, and we had to change, you know, and put VRV and air conditioning, because otherwise it was not going to happen.
Yeah, so
if you have this kind of problem, then you need to design in a particular manner.
See, for that I'll tell you the experience we felt in Jipmer also. Jipmer is in Puducherry, which is the hospital. What has happened? Remember one thing, hospitality and hospital, the rooms and the ward. The moment a patient comes inside the ward, he says, I am feeling cold, switch off the AC. There goes your whole system for a toss. And someone opens the window. If window is sealed, is a different problem, it is openable. And what has happened? All fungal growth in your diffuser area. You as a clinician, as an infection control, you face this difficulty. Now what we found the solution? Yes, pressurization with positive, negative, and in between barrier as a negative and ultimate. And even if he opens the window, because this we did the more study for the airborne infection control. Because when we were doing in the Harvard School of Public Health, our study was in the aircraft, a SARS affected patient in a long haul aircraft, how many times he has traveled to the toilet and came back, and how many people he has infected, and in the long area, the recirculation, how he has infected. And that is how they have, Harvard has given a design solution to the aircraft. Same way here, airborne infection transmission from the patient to the visitor or visitor to this barrier. And that is how the new air conditioning system with pressurization and also this germicidal
clearance. Generally, when you do air-conditioned buildings, you know, for all of you all, I mean, do you keep the windows in a manner that the guy can open?
So,
or
no. So that's where I'm coming from, that especially in our country, based with in our experience, we do not promote this open to open the window because of certain reasons, like could be emotion.
Oh, jump out also.
Jump out of the we have had cases.
Oh, that happened
we
with Bombay Hospital.
We have had multiple cases from the upper floors, patient coming out because of the stress. So we don't advocate to keep that thing with the patient. So you open it whenever you want. The only option is switch off the AC or switch it on when the temperature goes down.
So do you give fan also along with AC?
No, with that we used to we stop it. We don't, because that's again another you know a threat. You know, so we don't do that. Second thing is yes. As somebody pointed out, that you should have a mix of areas which are air-conditioned, non-air-conditioned. If you, one of the finest examples I have seen is Singapore Hospital Kutek Park, if you get a chance. They have, it's about 500 bedded, I don't know, Gaurav can correct me if I'm wrong. So it's about 500 bedded hospital, 300 out of which 200 beds is non-air-conditioned.
And they are
and it's all, it's on upper level,
upper
but
level.
They have been designed in a way that there are no floors above it and such, I mean, greenery around, so there's a herbal lawn and stuff like that.
Martin, you should do this.
And it's a wonderful place.
People listen to you. Or so you could do it.
Exactly.
We get driven, actually, by the client. That
no.
You can't.
The mistake has happened is it was sandwiched.
Okay.
What he said, if you keep, we also keep all the wards which are non-AC is top.
But sir, you know, in commercial, top floors are actually the
premium floors.
They are premium floors. Anyway, that's a, but it's a problem, so need to be, you know, resolved. So coming to the last question, you know, to the panel.
Not keeping windows open. AMRI fire in Calcutta, one of the reasons the fire authorities blamed for evacuating patients was there were sealed windows, tempered glass, which could not be broken easily.
No, so it has to have an Allen key. It's not that you can't just open it. You can't break it, you know, but you know, DGU profile will be very difficult to break also. But it has to be with an Allen key, which it should be openable. It's not that. But you cannot let the patient open it. That's what, you know, they are trying to tell you.
Fire regulations also?
Yes.
Yes,
yes. There are. Madam, can I, you know, take the next question and then VRV, we will, you know, I will explain to you during the tea session. The last question to you, you know, is around... I mean, this is my, you know, way of thinking. I may be wrong, but I think, you know, Indian hospital buildings are not very patient friendly. You know, neither are they relative friendly. They're not focused on, that's my, you know, take from whatever I have seen and whatever even I have designed. You know, the client also is not so much focused on patient as he's more focused on how much, you know, therapeutic area, diagnostic area, you know, so room chota ho jayega, chalega, you know, waiting area nahi hoega, chalega, you know, cooler nahi hoga, chalega. Toilets nahi hoga to bhi chalega, but I want, you know, endoscopy room, I want, you know, this room, I want that room. That is more of the focus. So can you just, you know, what is your thought around it and what are these areas, you know, you think should not be compromised as far as patient and relative goes? Martin, can we start with you?
What I want to say is that in my opinion, because I was involved in them, Medenta hospitals are very hospitable hospitals. Okay, I think they are patients and families are well taken care of. One thing I would like to mention, and I'm coming back now maybe, I'm sorry, is that one of the things about the cost and the accommodations of the patients has to do with the size of the structural bay you're going to choose. And that's an early choice, okay? And Medenta is based at 8.5 meters, in some cases by 9 meters, okay? All the hospitals in Medenta have always been built on 8.5 by 8.5 up to 9.0 meters per bay. Nowadays, you can build hospital at 7.6, 7.8, 7.2 even, okay? And that will size your patient rooms, and that will have a great impact on your total square footage or square meters of the hospital, okay? That being said, if we look at the patient accommodation, there's only one thing I would say, and it is this, I think somebody mentioned it, contemplation of nature can have a very big healing power. And it's now there is a new word, I think, it's called biophilia. We all love nature, okay? So to have access to nature, to have access to green space is very important, and it will really improve tremendously the patient experience, okay? And I'm coming back to my point I made earlier. If you have low-rise hospitals, then you can achieve that because the patient can look at gardens and green spaces. But of course, it calls for larger pieces of land. In a tower, it's extremely difficult to achieve that.
Okay. So,
particularly when you're talking about patient
designing around patient,
patient friendly means relative friendly. Yeah. Now the focus is not only relative friendly, even the staff focused. The stress on staff also impact. And in our area, in the government sector, there are more and more demand for waiting area. Now we are reducing it. But definitely, yes, in all the hospital, now only thing is we are trying to converge when the area is. In a ward, we need a day space. We need a refuge area in case of fire. So you can have a multiple area which is also serves as a refuge area. It can also act as a solarium for drying up your, you know, soiled bed. And because India has a 300 sunshine, full sunshine day, and the same thing becomes a day space and active area. So that way three spaces put in one, still achieving. And definitely the this target is at least taken care in all the government sector, but in the private sector also, they try to create through some other ambience and try to creep. It is not that people are giving away. Yes, what your point is right is, if I am trying to make a diagnostic center or something in 200 square yard of plot with a basement, are a toilet bhi rehne do, you know, waiting space, are only two people, let them loiter around. You know, these are happening. But that is all not the standard. If you think of hospital, I think I have seen all the hospital where these, you know, weightages are given. And it has to be given.
Okay.
Mother Nature is a great healer. That's
yes.
100%.
Yes.
So I have two points to make here, which are more observations as a person who's been to hospitals, taken family members to hospitals. Two big ones. One is the caregiver, or the relative in this case, is the person who decides the hospital is. We should never forget that. Okay? Because the patient is lying on the bed mostly and is just, if he heals and he goes home happily, that's all he cares about. It's the caregiver who decides whether the things were all right, how was the whole thing done, and so on and so forth. So that is something that going forward, I think, as people who design hospitals and build hospitals more, it is something to look at, one. Two, having a person as a caregiver around you gives you an immense sense of security, which actually helps in the healing process.
So caregiver means you're talking about hospital staff or
no,
you're talking
about
the
person,
relative.
The
attendant.
Okay.
Because if I have gone to hospital with my son and if I am around him, my sense is that his sense of security is going to be much larger. When I was a child and I went to hospital, my father was around me, the doctors were doing what they were doing, but having my father around was an immense sense of security for me. So if he is taken care of, and if he's not cribbing about this, that, and the other all the time, the hospital experience for me is far superior. It's something that we have to look at in the future. We've looked at it to a point. Some of the chains of hospitals, Apollo, Fortis, Max to a certain extent, are already doing this very consciously, but it's something that needs to come on.
Okay. Jayesh, can you, you know, elaborate on that? You know, because fMRI, I think, has done a lot of, you know, what he is saying, caregiver specific, you know, features. So
that's just for the class of course. But overall, we also look into it that there are multiple entry points, like an onco entry point would be a different as compared to a general main entry point of the hospital. We design it in the wayfinding is very critical, the internal circulations, the corridors which are dedicated to different kinds of people,
very important.
The lift scores, the floors are also divided as per the treatment or the zone which we are committing. There are mother and child zones which are there, so they are mostly the happy zones. So we normally keep them near a children's play area and a lawn outside. So all these factors are taken care of, even with medical tourism coming in and other functions which come in. So we tend to give a good attendant lounge, which might probably even have a bed or a small zone for them to relax in the night. There is also probably a theater which we can come up with
I love that, 40-plex in fMRI. I think it's a very unique concept, you know. People might be liking it, especially the caregivers, you know, whose patient is not very sick, you know. So he probably needs to break out, you know. So that's a very good idea. How does it work? Is it working? Is it free, first of all, or you have to pay? So are you aware, you know, what he's talking about? Fortiplex is a 35-seater, you know, cinema theater inside of Fortis Memorial Hospital in Gurgaon. I was amazed to see that, you know. But I think it's a good idea. Every hospital has auditorium any which ways, you know. So we did Asian Heart. Asian Heart has also 75-seater auditorium. Why not use it? Because programs will be once in a while. What are those rooms?
Wazoo is what?
Muslim, yeah.
Which we normally have airports, but why not give it to them?
Yes.
Now, especially when they're looking at certain sections.
That's been sensitive to the client, you know.
Yeah.
I remember once we lost out a project, and that became a very unique Islamic architecture monumental hospital in Saifi Hospital, Cherni Road in Mumbai. You know, we lost because we were not sensitive to this need. You know, so toilets were facing the Mecca, which is not allowed. You know,
yes.
They said you were not sensitive enough.
No, even
to understand,
in
you know?
Apollo, they go by all Vastu. Yeah. A lot of people are now following. Particularly, sometime architect feels perturbed that he designs everything and the Vastu consultant comes and makes the whole thing topsy turvy. He says.
Mrs. Neeta Imbani actually tore down the building of Harkesindas and built a new one because it was not Vastu compliant earlier. Can you believe that? Rajesh, you know, you come from an oncology cancer.
Yeah, so
very sensitive.
Light, ventilation, everything is given and all these, you know, add-on facilities. But the main point, I also represent another chain called Motherhood because apart from American Oncology, from the TPG Astra, I also represent Motherhood. So these are two different facts. One
so
is
Motherhood is a childbirth.
Yeah, childbirth.
Cloud
so that's
nine
a different,
kind.
Yeah, okay. So that's a different kind. And oncologists are different. So we should not differentiate there. Why should an oncology center always be tucked at the least important area of the building? Underground, basement, dark, dingy, where you know that anybody having an oncology patient has to take the lift and go down. So I think we need to come out of that. And probably you have to bring everybody into that light and open space. Bunkers need not be below ground. They have to be, it's best that they be above ground. So probably in most of our centers, barring one or two, the rest are all above ground. So the importance to the patient, whosoever is getting a treatment, whether he's coming for a heart surgery or an oncology or a childbirth, it's same.
Right.
So all these breakout spaces is used by everybody at the same level.
Okay.
The best idea for this to come out,
yeah.
Now we have found out, you know, you treat psychologically. You say the water table is so high, you cannot have basement. Okay. This is how you have to bring it. You see, when regulatory authorities also play a role.
But you have to put the kitchen there.
Huh? No. Nothing in the basement.
Where is Dharamshila Cancer Hospital's bunkers are in the basement or ground? So she follows that actually.
Yeah. No, but
Jayesh, you wanted to
that
say something?
Area is also actually has a water table. Because I know the architect who designed that, it was the Archal Kataria, and that time those areas were not allowed basement, being the regulatory. Now, two basement, No,
they did not allow, you know, using linear, using basement for putting in equipment like
AERB regulations, they used to give the first preference, unless there is, even in Lady Harding, etc., everywhere we said, then slowly people started getting it.
So Jayesh, you wanted to add something?
So there is also one more thing which you can try if you are doing in Shalimabad actually is that the bunker actually overlooks the sunken courtyard. So there is
okay. Yes, so that was my point. Yeah.
That's
you don't need to be on the ground,
yes.
As long as you have access to
basement
greenery.
Doesn't mean exactly that there is cannot be a natural light. You can always bring
it. You can have a lower ground, you can, you know, maybe taper the thing.
You
Martin, you wanted to say something?
No, this is exactly the point I was gonna raise.
I just
No, hospitals like AIMS, for example, or Medanta or Aster Medcity, huge, you know, buildings. I think there is something which I saw one of the conferences like this in Cochin, where they now have an app of the hospital. You enter the hospital, the app starts. You actually can navigate. But this is for campuses which are large campuses, because otherwise you get lost. You don't know where to go and how to, you know, so that's
technology.
And even
the Wi-Fi facilities have become, with the new government, has become so compulsory here,
right?
Because lot of, you know, like nursing cart, etc., all techno, they work on Wi-Fi.
Right.
You cannot just work without that.
Right. So any last couple of questions, if anyone want to ask, you know, it is open, and otherwise we will close. So this is Dr. Sanjay Upadhyay from Asian Institute of...
Good cafeteria for the relatives, because...
So you can go, sir, and have, you know, maybe you get time in Gurgaon, go to either of these guys. They have a food court inside the hospital.
A food court, yeah. Now it has become common.
But that's a big problem in Mumbai.
Sir, Mumbai is an FSI problem. We are, what, 600, 700 square feet.
But
these guys are... 1,000 square feet per bed.
That creates a very good impression as far as the relatives are concerned.
Kokila has a good food court.
Kokila?
Yeah.
Yes.
Because it's a huge complex.
A
huge,
yes,
complex. I think, yes, thanks to Dr. Manke. It's a huge complex designed by him.
Any other question?
Just a couple of questions. When you're starting off, like what we are going to be doing, making a building, how do you take into account the global warming that's going to come in over the next 15, 20 years? And how do you take care of that right now?
So you design a, you know, lead-rated green hospital. You design a, you know, green building,
envelope.
Which will take care of that, yeah.
And the other thing that I think in oncology especially that we tend to miss out is we don't have a separate counseling room, especially when you do an operation and we land up with saying we have told the patient's relatives that this is what's going to happen. And when at the end, when we come out and we have not succeeded, invariably, I've seen that most hospitals, the doctors discuss in the lobby where another 10 relatives of other 10 patients
are.
So
this
listening.
Is, sir, one of the rooms which get cut when you come down
you,
to 500,
to,
600 square feet per bed.
In fact,
this is the problem.
Fact,
so what he's trying to tell you,
no, in fact,
is,
I've been telling
is that you make a functional space program upfront.
Correct.
You put down your wish list, this is what I want. So if I give you that, then I would probably add 25 square feet per bed.
In fact, Vivek, that's what we have done. Even in the 30,000 square feet that we have 100 square feet of a separate room where we go and sit and talk to the patients. Relatives, both ICU and the OT. So it's a combined one. Patients critical in the ICU, we don't let them because it becomes an emotional factor at times. They need to break down. But when they're in the lobby, it becomes embarrassing for them. So I think every hospital should have
that. In fact, now the lately, all the theaters and ICU area, because we have this facility, because the doctor with his sterile cloth can walk into his and the people come from outside, and we don't allow them. Like for infection control, using technology, they are in the one waiting area where there is a telephone
screen
for any this thing, or plasma screen where the patient can be shown with the CCTV and all.
No.
This has been happening.
So one last question I take and then I will close this. So yes.
I'm architect Panjwani from Dehradun.
Dehradun. I like that place actually.
I have a question to the panel. That we normally, when we are designing the rooms, the question comes up whether the toilet has to be on the corridor side or the window side.
So that question, you know, I think, I mean, if you...
pros and cons to that.
So if you have a service floor, you know, understand the service floor concept. So if you have a service floor, better to have it towards the inside. Take the inpatient rooms above the service floor level. Else, if you don't have, then probably the only other way is to go on the outer side.
No, I'll answer. See, when you have an air-conditioned room, then the toilet, that bay, acts as a negative and a barrier between the corridor and all. So it is ideal, and then service floor is the one which takes out. And similarly, outside when you keep it, generally you want to see out. You don't want to block.
Cuts
but,
the window.
But there are designs available where you work out in such a way that you can have it there also. Because there is a mindset of some of the people in the different tier city, it's a seepage area, this is to be out and things like that. It is how you design the system and how you maintain it.
Yeah,
Martin, you wanted to say something?
No. My opinion, from what I understand and from my experience here, it's all plumbing. It's all a question of plumbing. Plumbing has to remain accessible.
Yes.
This is why we have shafts like you have in hotels on the patient wards. And behind every toilet, there has to be a shaft that is accessible. That's my understanding. And this is why these rooms, these bathrooms, cannot be on the outside wall.
No, when you have housekeeping done from the inside of the corridor, so if you have a dirty, you have a system of dirty corridor for OTs.
So we can have a dirty corridor. No, this is an old concept. All right, so let me now just close this session. They are available, you could talk to them during the refreshments also. But before I think one big round of applause for them, please.
For all of us.
I will call upon, you know, Selvan, project manager of Hospital Planning Infrastructure, you know, exhibition come conference, to give you all a small token of memento from our side, sir. Selvan.
Oh. Thank you. Thank you.
From the front. And after this, you know, is a tea break, and then we will join back.
Oh, yeah, you would want to retrieve that, right?